Well, we can learn so much from gardening. We can learn about other countries, and we can even learn about the medicine that they traditionally make from all of the plants that they grow. Well, I'm at the Latin American Studies Garden at Vanderbilt, and Avery, tell me, what is going on here?
Yeah, so this is our ethnobotanical garden. So we've got over 50 species of plants that are all native to Latin America and that are either used for medicinal or culinary purposes. There's a few plants that serve mainly as ornamental purposes, but all of these plants are native to Latin America. And I'd love to tell you about some of the medicinal uses.
Oh my gosh, yes. So this has the most beautiful leaves. Tell me all about it.
So this is known, this plant is native to Mexico and Central America, and it's called Yerba Santo in those regions. And it contains safrol, which you may know is the active ingredient in the sassafras root that was traditionally used to make root beer. We now know that safrol is a carcinogen, but it does supply this very peppery, spicy, anise-like taste that's very delicious. And so one of the uses of this leaf, in addition to its culinary uses, is that it can be put on your skin directly to take care of any skin parasites.
Well, Avery, for a Latin American garden, I'm seeing all kinds of things that are familiar to me, like this milkweed here.
Yes, this is a Mexican milkweed, so very similar to the species that we have here. And of course, it's very important for the life cycle of the monarch butterfly that migrates from Mexico all the way up to Canada each year and really needs this plant to lay its eggs and for its caterpillars to eat when they first hatch. But it also has a number of medicinal uses. Most importantly, the roots can be dug up and used in a tea to induce vomiting or to be used as a laxative. The sap of the plants, which also gives the milkweed plant its name, as you can see, there's a little bit of this milky sap. This is an irritant. It's what makes the caterpillars taste bad to any predators, but it also is an irritant for our skin and can be used against warts and other skin parasites.
Oh, what a neat thing to learn about. And then I also see, well, it looks a bit like our beautyberry.
The one that's native to the southeast of the United States is the American beautyberry. This is the Mexican beautyberry, same genus, different species, and it grows very well here. This one grows from Mexico all the way down to Bolivia, and you can make a leaf tea to treat stomach aches and diarrhea. The other thing that people, the Yucatec Maya, use the plant for is they will boil the woody parts, the stems and the roots, and essentially distill them down to a concentrate and then put that in a sweat bath. Throughout Mesoamerica, we find that Maya people rely on sweat baths. They're very spiritual, sacred spaces. They're also very practical. It's a way that people bathe. It's very important in prenatal treatments for women. And when a person is sick, they will go to the sweat bath to heal themselves. And so this liquid that's made from this plant is put within one of the sweat baths to help decrease the effects of rheumatism and to decrease fevers.
So this looks like the hibiscus that I grow at home.
Yes, it is. And it has medicinal uses that you may not be familiar with. And so people in Mexico will take the flower, which is, of course, very beautiful, but they'll boil it and make a tea out of it. And it's very effective against sore throats and coughs and things like tonsillitis.
Well, these beautiful flowers here look like a jasmine to me.
Yes, so this plant is native to Chile, and it's known as night blooming jasmine because the flowers open at night. Or the scientific name is Cestrum parki, and it is very important for the Mapuche people. So they will take the leaves and chop them up and dry them and then smoke them as a tobacco. They also believe that the plant has spiritual force called contra that is able to ward off black magic. And so they will take the woody stems that you can see in here, make them into crosses and put them around the outside of their house to protect them from any sorts of effects of black magic. The other thing is more recent is that a French group in 2011 did a study of the leaf extracts of Cestrum parki and found that it had spermicidal properties. And so they are now looking at this plant as a potential organic contraceptive.
I love the smell of lemon verbena, but I understand, Avery, you have a personal story with this.
Yes, so lemon verbena does smell delicious and is delicious, and it's used for a number of culinary purposes, but it also has medicinal purposes. And so primarily that would be using the leaves to make a tea to treat stomach ache and vomiting and diarrhea, so gastrointestinal disorders. And you can find it in Argentina and in Peru, in Brazil. And I was actually hiking in the Colca Canyon in Peru, and on the way down into the canyon started throwing up and felt terrible. And by the time I got to the house where I was spending the night, the woman who owned the house made me a tea of lemon verbena, and I woke up feeling great the next morning and ready to hike.
I see you have a pineapple sage, which I just love for the flowers.
Yeah, the flowers are red and very beautiful, and the leaves have just a lovely scent, which of course is where the name pineapple sage comes from. But it can also be very effective as a medicinal plant. And so again, making a leaf tea and drinking it helps with insomnia and anxiety. And it's actually been shown in a scientific study to be very effective against hypertension.
Wow, there's just so much study that's being done on all of these different plants. So it seems like so many of the medicinal plants, the way that you make medicine is to make a tea out of them.
Yes, and again, we have another example here. This is Tagetes lucida, also known as Mexican tarragon. So that, first of all, tells you that it is also used in cooking, and the leaves have a really nice flavor. But if you make a tea of the leaves of this plant, it's very effective in reducing stomach cramps.
Well, so I know it's a little late for them right now and a little hot, but the primroses, I do see them all over the place.
Yeah, so these grow really well in Nashville. This is the Mexican evening primrose. There are over 150 species that belong to the primrose genus, which is Enothera. It is native to the Americas. This one, of course, is native to Mexico, and it has really beautiful pink flowers. But it's also very effective as a medicine. The oil is valued, and this is true of this plant and this species, but is also true of primroses in general. The oil is valued and can be used to treat eczema and psoriasis. Very effective a treatment for that. There is still a lot of knowledge about medicinal plants. I would say that indigenous people and people that live closest to nature are the best holders of that knowledge. And plants are really important as medicines for many of the people in the world. About 80% of people in the world rely on plants as their first defense against illnesses. And many of our pharmaceuticals that we rely on here in our country and in other developed nations were actually derived from plants. So for example, aspirin is derived from a compound in willow bark. Quinine, which was very important historically in treating malaria, is derived from the cinchona tree that's native to Peru. And the list goes on, but plants are very important as medicines. And it's very important that we keep the biodiversity of this planet alive, because it turns out that plants with the most bioactive compounds grow in areas in rainforest regions, in more tropical regions that we need to protect these days.
Well, thank you so much for giving us a chance to look at this. Now, if people want to come out firsthand and learn more about these plants, how can they do that?
Well, first of all, you can stop by anytime. We're located right here on 31st Avenue, and this is an open garden. We welcome people coming to visit it and walking through. We're working on additional signage and information so that you can give yourself a self-guided tour. But you're also welcome to look us up on the Center for Latin American Studies at Vanderbilt University website, and you'll find a tab for the garden and contact us if you want to organize a tour.
This is fantastic. Thank you, Avery, so much for this time out in your garden.
Thank you.
For inspiring garden tours, growing tips, and garden projects, visit our website at volunteergardener.org or on YouTube at the Volunteer Gardener channel, and like us on Facebook.